grace is life, Lord, your grace is life to me. Your grace is life.
Your grace is life. Week 10 of the Gospel in 10 Questions. And tonight we're looking at one that is, it says we're live. Good. Thank you. All right. So this one tonight is kind of been a question that's been around for a long time, and it confuses a lot of people. It's put fear on a lot of people. I can't tell you how many people that I have encountered and worked with and prayed with that are worried about a sin that could be committed that would cause God not to forgive them. We refer to it as the unpardonable sin. That's what it says in the King James. Our more accurate language is the unforgivable sin. So we're going to look at what is it? What is the unforgivable sin? And is there such a thing since the cross? So let's just take a second. What's your feedback before we even start? Just preconceived ideas. What have you heard about the unforgivable, the unpardonable sin? What position has it put you in because of thinking it was something? Anybody have any responses? Yes, sir.
What I'd been told was it was us never accepting Christ as our Savior.
Brooklyn was going to answer for me. Okay. If you have been or know others who've been raised on a strict diet of religion, what it produces is people who battle with guilt. We talked about that a few weeks back. And then from that guilt, we have despair. When people have been taught and have heard that there is a sin that they could commit that would cause God not to forgive them, they spend their lives in guilt over certain sins that they commit, constantly confessing, which is basically ends up being a work in order to try to make sure that they avoid not committing this sin. Just tell yourself this right now, and those listening and watching on the internet, you are never beyond redemption. Write that down, get that in your mind, put that in your heart, and settle that no one is ever beyond redemption because of the cross. Now, remember, the cross is our filter. Those on the other side of the cross, when they were looking towards that, they really didn't even know what they were looking for, a Messiah, a Savior, some of them that would come and save them. There were heavy loads that they had to bear under the law. And they got to the point where they didn't feel like they could bear some of those burdens, and then therefore they had a sin that they felt like that God wouldn't forgive them. But at the cross, this was the promise. He came as the Lamb of God to take away the sin of the world. So here's a question. I want you to answer it. Did he do that? So at the cross, the sin of the world, the punishment for sin at the cross was eradicated. And as we heard Bishop Jamie Englehart say, we either believe that or we don't. And if we believe that he did it for the world, we need to be awakened to the fact that we're already sons. Why? Because he took away the sin of the world. Everybody was included that. The cross included the entire world. So no one is beyond redemption. Have you ever heard invited someone to church and say, well, if I came, the roof would cave in? Have you ever heard anybody say that? I've done so much, there's no hope for me. No one is beyond redemption, and no one is beyond hope, regardless of how they feel about themselves and how much sin they have committed in their life. They're not beyond redemption. They're not beyond hope. Certainly one of the greatest sources of anxiety is confusion. Wouldn't you say so? If people there's a different sources. We preached about anxiety here a few months back, but confusion over sin and over forgiveness can cause people to have anxiety. I have met individuals who have struggled their entire Christian walk, some 30 and 40 years, that are still guilt-ridden, that still don't believe that they've been forgiven of everything, and so they're working. I like the Message Bible. It says you don't have to redouble your efforts. We don't have to do double duty and work overtime, because when God forgave us through what Jesus did at the cross, it was once and for all. And if you believe that and receive that, you're secure. Now the enemy, yes, ma'am.
In Luke, say something about blasphemy of the Holy Spirit.
Don't preach my message before I get to it. Okay.
No, I was just wondering.
You're right. Yeah, it does, and we're going to get to it here in just a second. You're on the right trail, Missy. Good job. Preach it. That's right. Preach it, Missy. So what we need to do, what our job is to do, I believe, is to remove fear and anxiety from people about what they've been trying to do to earn God's grace and favor and forgiveness. If we can take that away, people can become more secure. They will begin to live the abundant life. But so many have been raised on a strict diet of religion that they're worried about a sin, that if they commit that sin, there's no forgiveness. So let's set the guide for the whole message tonight, that there is no one who's out beyond redemption, and there is no one who is beyond hope, because Jesus settled that at the cross. Yes, ma'am.
Doesn't that make a wonderful crutch? Because if you're living in sin and you think changing over to God is going to take all your fun away, you can say, well, no problem, I've already committed the unforgivable sin, so you might as well just go on and have fun, right?
Yes, I mean, people do say that we Christians use Jesus as a crutch, and if I need a crutch and it's Jesus, then I'll take it. I think as we go along tonight that some of that can be, we will see here in that question that you just, and that remark that you brought up, answered. So a lot of people, even believers, walk around thinking and become anxious over, if I do this, will God forgive me? But it really, and I've even heard people say they use this as a guide for life. Well, if I've been forgiven of it, I'll just do it. It's kind of like, don't ask permission, just ask for forgiveness. But we're not into asking for forgiveness because we've been forgiven, so we ask Holy Spirit for permission. But Paul even told us all things are permissible, but not all things are beneficial. I mean, it may be permissible even by the laws of our land to do certain things, but just because it's permissible to do it doesn't mean that it's beneficial to my life and to those around me. And then if I become a stumbling block to my brothers and sisters, then it's not beneficial to them. Okay? So here are a few things. Is there an unforgivable sin? And if so, what is it? Take this question to any Bible commentary and you'll end up with a list of candidate sins. And I'm going to give you a similar list, that if you were reading commentaries and you were reading about the unforgivable sin, you would find a lot of different things. The bad news is theologians say one or all of these sins are unpardonable. The good news is theologians are sometimes wrong. Because if you listen to this list, I know that I've committed more than one of them on the list. So if it's unforgivable, help me, Jesus. So if you've committed one of the sins or all of the sins on this list, but rest assured that none of them that I'm going to give you is unforgivable. Why? Because we've already settled that we have been forgiven because of the cross and the blood of Jesus that forgave all of the sin of the whole world. That's pretty powerful. So listen to some of these. Comment if you want. Here's a list of some of the things that theologians have said is the unforgivable sin. One, having an attitude that calls evil good and good evil. Having a lack of reverence. I mean, growing up, if we got on the platform, this was the Holy of Holies. There was an invisible curtain that came down right here, and if you stepped one, get off that platform. Everything was holy. Let's settle this at Grace Life. There's nothing up here that's holy. Only the people that step up there that are holy, that play the instruments, that make that instrument holy because of the person, not the instrument. I want to chase a rabbit for just a second. Satan cannot and does not possess inanimate objects. It's impossible. Satan cannot enter our sound system and cause it to go haywire. He can't enter your washer or your dryer, your hot water tank or your car. He does not possess, nor does he have the power to control inanimate objects. He can't produce any seed. So anything that we have placed on the enemy, he doesn't have that much power. Let me give you a scripture. Greater is he who is in me than he that is in the world. So if I have a spirit on the inside of me that's greater, a lesser spirit cannot overtake a greater spirit. Okay? Don't want to chase that any further. Being stubborn and unteachable. I'd like to say that one was unforgivable, but we can be stubborn. God still loves us. Not loving the Lord with all your heart, soul, and mind. Willing or habitual sin. See, I've heard down through life, not from my dad, okay? I'm not putting him in a bad light, nor others, but I have heard preached that if you have habitual sin, I'll just give you an example. Someone who stays in habitual drug addiction, that God can't forgive that. Baloney. That's baloney. I have a sugar addiction. I'm working on it. I'm not confessing that. Okay, that's right, babe. What we do is, what I was trying to say is, we put some addictions over other addictions. But God's given us a new DNA, and so we don't have addictive personalities. All right, and that's what we confess. Having unconfessed sin. Having unrepented sin. Now, what the difference between unconfessed and unrepentant sin is, I don't know. I guess you can confess a sin that you've committed but not be repentant over it, according to the theologian's list. Harboring unforgiveness in your heart, that's an unforgivable sin, according to theologians. Taking the Lord's name in vain. Now, my mom thought that. We weren't even allowed to say gee or gee whiz because it was a derivative of God, and that would be using his name in vain, which is another of the commandments that some people think is an unforgivable sin. Having disrespectful thoughts about the Holy Spirit or blaspheming the Holy Spirit. Now, granted, there's some bad things on that list, but every one of them have already been forgiven through the blood of Jesus. What we have to do is either believe that it has been forgiven and receive that, or stay in unbelief over them and don't believe that they have been forgiven, and then what happens is we have to work for our righteousness to be forgiven over those things if you don't believe that Jesus already did the work at the cross. If we have to continue to do something, then we don't believe in the finished work of the cross, because then Jesus left something undone that we have to finish in the work that we do. Not so. So, let's look at a couple of these. What sins have been forgiven? All of them. The commandment, let's just look at this one. The commandment to love your Lord God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength is part of the old law-keeping covenant. Jesus identified it as the greatest commandment in the law. Read it in context. Matthew 22, verse 36 through 37. So what happens is the Pharisees come and they're trying to trap Jesus, because that's what they were always trying to do. They were trying to catch him in something. But what did they use? The only thing that they could apply to ask Jesus anything was the law of Moses. And so they would bring things out from the law of Moses and try to trap him and trick him in that. Because he was a Jew, he had been raised as a Jew, he was trained in the law, he was a rabbi, and so they were trying to get him to say something against the law that they could claim blaspheming on him, and then they could have him killed or removed or excommunicated from the Jewish religious system. And they say, which of the commandments? Now, when they say which of the commandments, they are specifically speaking of the Ten Commandments written on stone. Now, we know that there were 613 other laws that had been handed down, and that there, by the time Jesus showed up, there were 1,500 added oral laws that the Pharisees, Sadducees had added to the written law. But they specifically say, in the law of Moses, which is the greatest commandment? And Jesus answers the question in context. Now, if I'm asking you a question about 1956 Chevrolets, you're not going to give me an answer about a 2018 Nissan. It's out of context. So when they specifically ask about law, so Jesus goes to the law and he pulls out and he says, the greatest of the law is to love the Lord thy God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And the second, he goes a little bit further, is likened unto it, love your neighbor as yourself. Context is the law. But people have beat themselves up. Religious leaders have hounded people with, well, you don't love God if you don't show up on Sunday morning. Or you don't love God with all your heart if you're not giving 10%. And if you don't, see, and then we start putting condemnation and judgment on people. And that's not even what Jesus was talking about. Because at the cross, he did away with, 2 Corinthians, the third chapter, that old government of death had been done away with, and now we have a government of affirmation through the Spirit. We've been accepted in the Beloved. So on this side of the cross, there's only one law, only one commandment that Jesus gave to us, that you love the way he loves. And he gave us the example of how to do that unconditionally. So that's, if someone says, well, you don't love the Lord your God with all your heart, well, Lord, forgive me, that's under the law, I'm not held under that. Excuse me, plus I've already been forgiven. So that's not an unforgivable sin that anyone could hold over your head. What about willful sin? Have you ever heard of, well, willful sin can't be forgiven because you willfully did it. You didn't know, I mean, you didn't, God's not going to forgive that because you did it out of your own free will. All sin is willful. All sin is, I'm sorry. Before the cross, if we don't accept it, that we've been forgiven, that's what happens. And I have a new nature, the divine nature attribute of God. That's right. So willful sin is no different than what would be the opposite, unwillful sin. I mean, is that somebody holding your gun? I really don't want to do this. This is out of my will, but I'm going to go ahead and do it. All sin is willful, and God gave us a free will. In Psalm 103, verse 3 says, if God kept a record of sin, who could stand? The good news is not that God has only forgiven some of your sins, the ones you did by accident, but he has forgiven all of your sins, even the ones that you did out of your own free will. So we've basically, we could go line by line on every one of these that theologians have named as an unforgivable sin, and we can give scripture to prove they've been forgiven. So what about taking the Lord's name in vain? Now, that was a big one when I was growing up. I remember the first time I got my mouth washed out with soap. I called my brother a B-U-T-T. And that's exactly what I said, and I got my mouth washed out with soap. That was the first time. The second time was when I used the Lord's name in vain. Gee whiz. And my mom didn't like that. And so I grew up having a respect for the name of God because basically I didn't want soap in my mouth. That was smart. I learned real quick I didn't want Dawn dish liquid in my mouth. and then a little bit of water and gargle it. I had it easy. Would you get a whole bar? Yeah, I had that one time too. We're not here to talk about my sin tonight, though. Yeah, confess one to another. It was just something you didn't do. We learned it in Sunday school as one of the Ten Commandments, and don't take the name of the Lord God in vain. But really, that's not even the context of that commandment from the Old Covenant. It's not using his name in such a way as slang. Now, that's disrespectful and we shouldn't do it, but to use the Lord's name in vain is to speak against the power of God and what his name brings, what his name offers, what his name can do, the power is in that name. And if we don't use it effectively and in the right way, then we're using it in vain. I got one amen from my wife. She agrees with me because she told me about it. I mean, my dad, love him, and he's hilarious, and he used a lot of things as humor that really wasn't what he was trying to convey. But, you know, he would talk about God is in heaven, and he said, he'll make you a grease spot on life's highway. He'll just strike you with lightning, you know. A little bit of humor, but some fear mixed in there to get you to straighten up. But that's basically the way a lot of religious people grew up, that God was some Thor with a hammer in heaven, a mythological God that was going to strike you down for using his name in vain or incorrectly. But that's not God. That's not who he was then. That's not who he is now. And he forgives us even if we misrepresent and misuse his name. Now, we don't use that as an excuse to go around using God's name any way we want to use it. But he still forgives us. He has forgiven us over those things, and he's not going to make you a little grease spot. Matthew 12:32 says, anyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man will be forgiven. That's what Matthew 12:32 says. So if you speak ill or even curse the name of God or Jesus, it's according to Matthew 12, which is New Testament, but still Old Covenant, because Jesus had not gone to the cross yet. Same verse, Matthew 12. But anyone who speaks against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven, either in this age or in the age to come. Right there is where we get our problem. So now this is where we really get into, okay, you can curse God, you can use Jesus' name. Just personally, I have a difficult time with GD. That's just me. You know, I could take just about anything else in the world or amongst people, but that's one that I wouldn't let people talk about my mom or my wife, so I don't want people talking about my God either. But even in that, they're forgiven. That's forgiven. But the scripture says, and this is where people, theologians, have taught that then if you blaspheme or you speak slander against the Holy Spirit, that you won't be forgiven. When I was young, I went to a spiritual debate. I don't look back now and say, well, that was kind of awkward that we were having a spiritual debate. But Jerry Falwell was sitting on one side in a chair, and on the other side in the same room on the platform was Madam Mary O'Hara, an atheist, okay? And there was a mediator, a moderator, who was giving questions, and they were debating back and forth. I mean, she said everything under the sun. She cursed God. She spit on the Bible. She talked Jesus like he was a filthy, rotten scoundrel. But when they started talking about the Holy Spirit, she clammed up. Now, I don't know why. I don't know. I think it's probably because somewhere, somehow, even though she was an atheist, she had gotten a hold of some theologian or some scholar had told her that if she spoke against the Holy Spirit, that she wouldn't be forgiven, that she would die on the spot, she would go to hell, whether she believed in it or not. Somehow, some way, she got a hold of. See how powerful that was for even for someone who didn't believe in God, that she had in the back of her mind somehow that blaspheming the Holy Spirit was a sin, that if she did it, she wouldn't be forgiven. So can you imagine those who have a strict religious background, who are full of guilt, that when a scripture like this that's used out of context and taught to put fear on people, no wonder so many Christians have lived full of anxiety and can't rest in the finished work of the cross because of teachings like this from Matthew, the 12th chapter. So here Jesus identifies the one thing that cannot be forgiven, namely speaking against the Holy Spirit. Now, we're going to look for the next couple of minutes what that really means, okay? Because I will guarantee you, I've even had questions today on Facebook about, well, isn't the unforgivable sin blaspheming the Holy Spirit? According to the words of Jesus, yes, but not like it's been taught. It's nothing like what we have been taught. And I want to speed it up just a second here. What about bad-mouthing the Holy Spirit? So we've heard a lot of people talking about, you know, don't attribute the works of God, works of the Holy Spirit, to the devil. That would be blaspheming. I hear about, again and again, obsessive-compulsive disorder and anxiety disorder characterized by hard-to-shake thoughts. The writer of this book that I'm reading, these are his words here. I want to read to you. I have struggled with the issue of unforgivable sin for the last 20 years. I have the most terrible thoughts against the Holy Spirit. I hate this blasphemous and angry thoughts and my inability to stop them. Often my days are filled with confession over these terrible acts. The more I confess, the worse it gets. I recently was diagnosed with OCD. So what he's saying is, because he has this disorder of being obsessive and compulsive over things, that when he was taught that the blaspheming of the Holy Spirit couldn't be forgiven and he lived anxiously making sure that he didn't, he was obsessively and compulsively repenting. He was obsessively and compulsively confessing everything that he could possibly think of to make sure that he would be forgiven of all the sins that he was committing. That's, wow. Even those who don't have not been diagnosed with that disorder have religious OCD because of the teaching they've gotten in. They've become obsessive and compulsive about confessing to make sure they don't burn in hell, that God forgives them, that God loves them. That's why it's so important for us. That's why we keep pounding and knocking on the door to remove grave clothes from you, to get you into a mindset of freedom, to get you into a mindset of fear being released from you, and to get you in a mindset that you are secure as a son, that God has forgiven you. I think that's incredibly good news. There are numerous stories, heartbreaking stories, about bad fruit from bad theology. A lot of people have bad fruit, and it's not necessarily a product of sin, it's a product of bad theology. It's bad theology to teach people to live in fear that they could possibly do something that would cause God not to love them and not to forgive them over something that they've done, especially after the cross. Then what Lisa's told us many times, you make the blood a common thing. You trample back over the Son of God and the work that he did at the cross to think that God wouldn't forgive you over something that you've done. Wow. We've been told that our salvation depends on our ability to say the right things, believe the right things, never stumble, and that if we do, disaster is inevitable. We simply, listen to this. You and I are not designed and we were not created to carry that heavy of a burden. But week in and week out, all across America and across the world, men and women stand behind pulpits and put heavy burdens on people that they were never meant to carry. That ends up being an obsessive compulsive disorder in the religious realm of doing this, and if you don't, then you have to confess it and you have to repent over it. If you don't get anything else tonight, get this. Write it down. tweet it, snap it, do something. If you're worried that you have committed the unforgivable sin, stop worrying. You haven't crossed the line. Because worrying that you have committed the unforgivable sin is a sure sign that you haven't. Did you get that? Worrying that you have committed the unforgivable sin is a sure sign that you haven't. Because if you thought you had, if you thought you had blasphemed the Holy Spirit, then you probably wouldn't even be worried about it. So what does it mean to speak against the Holy Spirit? Here we go. Mark, the third chapter, I believe this is probably what you were talking about missing. Mark 3, verse 28 and 29. Truly, I tell you, people can be forgiven all their sins and every slander that they utter, but whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will never be forgiven. Now, those are the words of Jesus, and that's prior to the cross. Because at the cross, we know everything changed. Because Hebrews 7:12 says that when there was a change in the law by necessity, or when there was a change in the priesthood, by necessity there was a change in the law. And the priesthood changed. Jesus is now our high priest after the order of Melchizedek, the tribe of Judah, not the tribe of Levi. So that old order faded away, that old glory passed, and we have come on. We've been transformed from glory, the old glory that faded away, to the new glory, which is the glory of the new covenant, which is brighter, which has never lost its brightness and never will. And so it's all changed. But Jesus did say those words. So what does it mean to blaspheme? I used to think a blasphemer was someone who spoke the Lord's name inappropriately. But here's what it is, if you want the definition: to slander or to speak against someone in a manner that injures or discredits their good name. All right, now I'm going to use that Greek word from a scripture, Romans the third chapter, verse 8. Why not say, as some slanderously claim — the word slanderously there is blaspheme. Blasphemo in the Greek. Same Greek word that is used in Mark 3:28. Why not say, as some slanderously claim, that we say, let us do evil that good may result? Their condemnation is just. So he's showing here, they're talking about Paul, or Paul is talking here. When people accused Paul of preaching grace as a license to sin, he said their reports were slanderous and blasphemous. In other words, he's saying they're telling you the things that they're telling you about grace, that it's a license to sin, and when they do it, they're causing my reputation and the good news that I'm bringing about to be put in a bad light. Why would you do that? Why would you believe, if I talked evil, if I come over here to Duffy and I start talking slanderously and blaspheming against Gary, but Duffy has a personal relationship with him and he knows him and he knows his character, they've been friends for a long time, he either has to believe what he knows about Gary to be true, or he's going to take my word over what he knows about Gary. Notice what I said there. He has to believe what he knows about Gary to be true, or he's going to take my word over his character, which becomes blasphemous towards Gary's good name. I'll explain it a little better. Okay. When people accused Paul of preaching grace as a license of sin, he said their reports were slanderous and blasphemous. In other words, their claims were false and injurious to his reputation and message. To blaspheme the Holy Spirit is to slander him. It's to say something against his ministry, against his work, against his power. And why would someone do that? Because they don't believe. Only a person who doesn't believe that the Holy Spirit is who he says he is and came to do what he said he was coming to do, the promise of the Father, would be blasphemous towards the Holy Spirit. See, so what it boils down to then, blaspheming the Holy Spirit comes from, and this is the only unforgivable sin, unbelief. What Gary said from the beginning. You don't believe who Jesus is. You don't place your faith. You don't receive who Jesus is. Because who tells us who Jesus is? The Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit comes to convict the world of sin. And really what he's doing when he's convicting the world of sin, he's convincing them of who Jesus is and what he did. Then he convinces us who have believed of our righteousness that it's a gift. It's not something that we work to earn or work to keep. And then, so he's convincing the world, that's all of us, of three things. Those who are unbelievers, of that Jesus died for us, it's the good news of the gospel. That's what he's convincing us of. Those of us who are righteous and we are believers, he's continually convincing us that we don't have to earn, to keep, or to receive the righteousness of God. It's a gift. And he constantly reminds us of that. So that when we do sin, when we do miss the mark, when we do make a mistake, he's there to remind us, hey, I've already taken care of that. You are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Now awaken yourself to that. Repent. Change your mind. Change your direction. Look to God. Look to Christ. Hear his words. And then he's convincing the world of the third thing, that the condemnation and the judgment has already come. And it was placed on Jesus at the cross. He said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all judgment to myself. And that the prince of this world has already been cast out. That's where judgment lies. It lies on Satan. He's already been judged and condemned. And all he tries to do is convince us that we're not righteous, that we're not the children of God, that we don't have the benefits of the kingdom, that keeps us in anxiety, that keeps us thinking that we could do something that God wouldn't forgive us of. Which boils down to, then, unbelief. Doesn't that make a whole lot more sense than trying to figure out what blaspheming Holy Spirit means? I've been in classes in Bible college that we spent weeks trying to figure out, and what we ended up with was a list, just like we gave at the beginning of the night in our teaching. All we could come up with were lists. But when we can look and really, really study the words, it's amazing that I had Greek and Hebrew in Bible college. I'm not a scholar by any means, I'm just a student, but I did have classes to learn how to conjugate Greek verbs. But we didn't look at things like blasphemo to find out what it really meant, to find out how someone could do that. We took it as that it meant, oh, you just are calling the things of God. We give credit to the devil for what Jesus did. And people do that, but God will forgive that. He would forgive that in a heartbeat. But what the only sin that will send you to hell that becomes the unforgivable sin is unbelief. You can give me a list of anything, and I'll tell you, he forgives you if you'll receive that. He has forgiven you by the work that Jesus did at the cross. But if you stay in unbelief, whether it's manifesting as homosexuality or pornography, you can give a list of anything. Boils down to just the example that I gave of Duffy and Gary. Do you believe who Holy Spirit is? And what he came to do was to remind us of the words of Jesus and to remind us of the works of Jesus. I like what Jamie Englehart said. He's a helper, not a doer. He wants to work in you. He's given you the power to do the things in the kingdom that need to be done. Let's see here, make sure I covered all of this. Okay, I want to give you a couple more things here. We discredit Jesus and we slander Holy Spirit by thinking we will be judged as sinners or that God punishes us for our mistakes. That's blasphemous. It's slanderous to think that God doesn't forgive us of our sins, that he doesn't forgive us of our mistakes. It discredits Jesus and slanders Holy Spirit by thinking that we can make ourselves righteous. That's what blaspheming Holy Spirit is. We are slandering Holy Spirit's work and the name, we're discrediting the name of Jesus by believing that we can work to earn his righteousness because it's a gift. What does that boil down to? We don't believe. One last one. Third aspect of Satan. We discredit Jesus and slander the Holy Spirit by thinking we must act before God will forgive us. In other words, confession and repentance have to come before he forgives us. Forgiveness, what that does is we're putting the cart out in front of the horse. But believing that he has already forgiven us, all we do by confession and repentance is acknowledge that the work is already done. We're not doing anything to activate God to work. The work has been finished for forgiveness of sins. Wow. Who were the number one blasphemers in the Bible? The Pharisees. Why? Because they didn't believe that Jesus was the Son of God, even to the point that when he went to the cross and fulfilled every prophecy that they knew of the Messiah to be fulfilled and still didn't believe. That's blasphemy. Even when Caiaphas ripped his own garments as a sign of blaspheming and would shout out at Christ that he was the blasphemer, he himself was the one who was blaspheming because he didn't believe. So I hope that somehow, some way, we can see the simplicity of things that we have made very complicated in the scripture, which really boils down to being bad fruit from bad theology that has come from theologians who have given us bad lists of things to do or not do. Any comments? Yes.
Yeah, I think it's become complicated because when we hear blaspheming, that's just, you just may as well hang it up, you're done, you know. But in the context of that word, blasphemo really means slandering. You know, I can slander you. And we've all done it after we've been saved, because I know I have before questioned, you've been in a church service and you've seen someone over here dancing in the spirit. Like, oh, they're just crazy. They're not Holy Spirit, you know, or you're at another church service and it's like, no, that's not it. Well, you're not believing it. You're doubt, you're mocking the Holy Spirit. Like when they were filled in the upper room, oh, that's not the Spirit. They're just drunk. You know what I'm saying? So, but I've already been forgiven. I know that. You know, once and for all, it's done. He's not coming back to die for me to confess every sin every time I confess a sin, because the blood is not uncommon. It's not common. It's supernatural. It means he only did it one time. So when I confess that, and that took me a long time to get to that point, because I was a constant confessor of before I went to bed to make sure that I was saved. But now, if I do say I'm sorry, it's not because I'm saying it to be saved. But I just wanted to make it clear about, you know, the blaspheming part, you know, because I think we've all probably done it. Everyone in church has judged another church or another service or somebody else. Oh, they're not, you know what I'm saying? So, but what blaspheming, that is what the real term of blaspheming means from the definition of that, is just speaking slanderously, just mocking, not understanding, and, you know, that kind of thing.
It's the nature of Pharisees to compare. You know, they said, thank God I'm not like that man. And so when we've been in services and someone could be, let's say, manifesting and speaking in tongues, prophesying, slain in the spirit, dancing, just anything demonstrative that, or even if we go to another church that's not emotional at all and it's just preacher's monotone. Some churches don't even have instruments or believe in instruments. And so if we would speak against that in a slanderous way, that's blaspheming. Because who are we to say that God's not in that? So that's not the unforgivable sin. It's unbelief that comes, then it comes out as we don't believe at all. Even for ourselves. So any other questions or comments before we go? Yes.
Well, I'm sitting here thinking about the all this you're talking about is great. But I'm also thinking there's another element to it, and it's in the church, it's in the world, it's everywhere I've been for the last 62 years. There is a desire to make everything complex. Nothing can be simple. And the more complex we make the ministry, it seems, the more mysterious it is. And the more mysterious it is, the more attractive it is. And I don't think Jesus was that way. I think it was simple. I think he said what he meant what he said, and that was it. And I think of all the time and energy and money that's been wasted in my lifetime. I was born in the Bible Belt of Texas. They love to argue. I grew up in a family that argued, but they had the same religion. And it was religion. It wasn't salvation. It wasn't freedom, but it was bondage. And I think that's the adversary's approach to us. And I think if we ever see past that, that's when we really get heaven on earth.
That may have been the best thing that said all night, because that boils down to what religion is. It makes everything complex when Jesus is very simple. He said it was so simple that a child would not err therein. So it's childlike faith that you tell them that Jesus said this and he did this for them, and they believe. It's that simple. That was profound, but good and simple. And yeah, putting too many hoops out in front of them to jump through this and do that and dot all your I's and cross all your T's and smile and wear the right clothes and drive the right car and give the right amount of money, and then you might make it. Thank God that's not what it is. And we don't know it all. By any stretch of the imagination, we're still learning. But one thing that I do know, that if this is all we've got so far, and there's this much freedom in it, the more that we can learn and the more that we can break it down and be simple and get rid of the complexity, the more freedom we can have. And that's joy. That's enjoying life. One thing that we say all the time is, if the Lord says anything about us, he says, you've preached me too big and too good. And the other thing that we're learning is we're going to enjoy life. And we'll make a statement, and you can do what you want with it. But I plan on living forever right here. I plan on living forever right here. One of my good friends, minister, I'm seeing transformation in his theology. And it's interesting, and it's victorious, and it's freeing, and it's exciting to see people in all walks of life that are coming from all different religions and all different denominational backgrounds that we used to think we all had it together, and they're being set free. And it's really refreshing. It's really refreshing, and I'm excited about it. So in planning on living forever right here, we don't neglect to plan for the future and for our loved ones, because we're going to leave an inheritance to our children and grandchildren, but we're going to enjoy ours right now too. And it's fun. And that's what we want you guys to learn, that we can enjoy. That's heaven on earth. Anybody else? Okay. All right. Don't forget, Sunday morning, we will be having acknowledging our graduates in our 11 o'clock service. We have a gift for all of them. There's about 7 of them. So come out and support them. Show your love for them. And we are starting a Sunday morning series for the summer on the parables of the kingdom. We're going to be looking at the parables that Jesus taught. You know, he didn't teach without doing it in parables. That was his format and method of teaching, was parables. And he has a lot of them on the kingdom. And that's what we're going to be looking at through the summer months and weeks. And Then on Wednesday nights, Lord willing, next Wednesday night we'll have our worship Wednesday, our first Wednesday worship. Pastor Hank will be in charge, Lord help him, with worship, prayer, and just ministering to the Lord. And then we will start the second week in June on looking and teaching and learning from each other about the works, the ministry, and the gifts of the Spirit. And I think that's one of the missing ingredients that we want to continue to marry with the grace message, is the power of the Spirit. Okay, we love you. God bless you and strengthen you. Be careful as you go, fellowship with one another, and we'll see you Sunday morning.